Madison High School.
Loser.
We're all at the same parties.
Outcast.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah. He was
a punk. It was like a group from all the different high schools that were kind of musicians.
Come on, look at you, look at me now. That's why I picked on you.
Yeah. Even though we all went to different schools, and we all kind of ended up hanging at the same parties.
Were you like popular guys, or did you?
I was the man. You don't even know.
I was goofy.
You were the goofy one.
No, I wasn't really goofy, but I was, like, kind of goofy.
He was goofy. I went to school with him.
Is it weird to have, like, an adoring crowd, like, crazy for you now?
It is. It's weird. It's something I always dreamed about. And now it's like I'm living my revenge because I never got any attention back when I was a little kid, so.
Yeah, are you ever going to go to your high school reunion?
I can't wait. I'm going to come in a helicopter.
I remember these guys had, we practiced and they like 2 hours of sleep and had to go move furniture. You know, nobody would call in, I'm not going to practice. We put in work.
And then deliver pizza and then practice.
Right. Furniture delivery.
He delivered pizza on a bike.
Yeah.
A lot of people are going to college, getting their education for their real job or whatever. It was like that was the days when we were playing the clubs. We had to go out and sell tickets to our own shows and try to work and rehearse all night and write songs and all. It's like we paid our dues for the amount of years, but the hard work and persistence and luck and everything finally paid off.
Who were people that were key to your development as artists?
Tom Morello, I think, is amazing.
Fantastic.
It's amazing and very influential. So, for me.
I'm hip-hop influenced. That's me.
And then, I don't know, bands like Faith No More and
Early Chili Peppers, early Faith No More. Kind of made us realize there was more to music than just straight heavy metal. We heard bands like the early Faith No More and Chili Peppers, and then we heard a heavy band like Prong that was grooving. And then we heard the first Rage first came out and how they had all the mood changes. You know, they would bring it up and down, the dramatic changes. So we kind of got all the ideas and tried to put it together. Trying to do something that nobody else has really done, which I think we have.
Who ever thought it out and go, we want to have this sound? It was just our sound. This is the way it came out of our amps and the way I sing.
We liked heavy music, like, say, you know, any heavy bands, Morbid Angel, whatever like that, but we hated all the fast drumming and the fast stuff, so we just took everything to a groove.
Nobody sounded like us, so people were like, damn, we were heavy. And when everybody, the first time they heard us, were like, oh my God, I remember that. There's nothing like that going on back when we first started. Now that we came out, there's been all the hybrid bands.
There's so many Korn imitation bands now. It's like, it's funny, I mean, but.
In the early days, it was just so powerful and mind-blowing. I remember when I walked in and first heard it together, I was all, oh my God, I would shit my pants. It was something new.
This is the rock band known as Korn. They have the number one record in town right now.
Korn?
Korn, yeah.
Korn.
People come up to me and ask about the name, and it seems to me that everybody has their own Korn story.
Like, to me, it kind of means that it doesn't matter what your band's called.
And we're trying to think of a name, and this Korn popped in my head. I'm all, Korn, we're all, fuck yeah.
Name or not, the music makes the name, you know, because Korn is a dumb name. But once the band gets established, then it makes the name cool.
There's a story behind the name, but we can't say it here.
You can't?
No.
Do you want to?
It's obscene.
Make really allusions
kind
to
of a
it?
Joke. Nope.
No? Okay.
Kind of a joke.
Some of you guys know.
I bet all of them know.
When we first started out, it took us so long.
So long to
create our
acceptance.
Mob of fans
and
people
that got it, right.
When we first started out, oh my
God, I mean, many shows, people going, you
suck.
We
look at our crowd and be like,
you suck.
We're looking at our crowd and like the people, the way they looked, and we're like, because like we toured with some bands like Megadeth and Danzig, and you see Marilyn Manson, you see these people going,
what? Let's do it, what Korn's all about, and people are liking it.
Part of a CMJ.
Yeah, it feels good,
like,
to me.
Honored, really. It's cool. Just like that's where we started out on all the college stations, and we got
now
to
a year
like,
later. We get to
a
see
year
some,
later,
some
now we
excellent see. Results.
You think sometimes people say, "Oh, it's too hard. It'll never make it on the radio." The music.
Oh, let me tell you a little something here.
Oh my God, I've heard that so many times.
All the radio stations had told us they would not play it. Now they're playing it.
What's
all I
up?
Got, I got to say is,
what's up?
Who died, huh? Over your dead body? Will somebody die? Because you're playing it now.
Right? Exactly.
And you know who you are.
You too.
Eat this.
You've written these personal lyrics. Do you ever feel weird about performing them live?
Well, I do on one song. I won't perform it live, but it's a release. I'm doing it for kids too. They get to come to the shows, get all those aggressions out, have a good time, and just feel, you know, leave feeling like they got it off their chest, you know. So I mean, it's working out good. Lots of kids relate to what I'm talking about. I'm happy for that.
You didn't put the lyrics in. How come?
Because I want people. Now they're too disturbing. Yeah. I wanted people to really listen to the music and figure out what I'm saying. Because when you put lyrics in there, just people sit down and go, they don't really listen to the music. So, wow, that's cool. Yeah, when you get the album, you find new stuff in it. You're just always listening. And if anyone doesn't understand what I'm saying, I'm probably not saying nothing at all. So there's a couple tracks there I don't say nothing. So anyone who wants to know. I went to a high school that had a pipe band. No. And I learned to play in there. And then I took private lessons. I used to compete in the games in California. And it was a hobby. And then I got in this band. I wanted to play a song with them. And it worked out.
It's an unusual instrument for a young fella to play.
I know, people young trip out on it, but kids
say.
I don't remember what I said.
Get
I
beat
said,
up when you're a little kid.
Yeah.
That's how you come up with
picked
them.
Picked on and that thing's not going your way. It's just life. Everybody goes. I wrote a song about a guy in San Diego that took a swing at me. So he'd go back to Bakersfield. Well, I didn't understand that. I bent down and tried to swing at me, and our road manager, Jeff, knocked his ass out. So that song's Clown.
Let's talk about this album cover.
Monkey came up with it.
It's kind of show you like the dark side of everything that's innocent, pretty much, you know, because without this, it's an innocent picture. But when you add the shadow, it's the dark side to the picture. You know what I mean?
I think the bottom line is people, they get really disturbed by this, are people that are bored, and they want to get disturbed by something like this. And when there's this whole world going on, and they want to look at this and go, oh, that bothers me. That's exactly. A bored person, right?
My favorite singer in the whole world is in my band.
Some look at the time I looked back into my life. You wanna touch me to see what's in my eyes. Why do you make me remember my hate, all the shame? Don't you hate me sometimes?
When I sing, it's just like getting any kind of a high. You just go in that place, it's totally like a high. You don't have to think about keeping yourself grounded. You just go to that certain place, and it's really intense and fun.
He writes about stuff that's like personal problems with himself, and it's just, he had no idea it was a coincidence that half the world has the same problems
yeah,
he does.
I had no clue.
So that's all it is. It has nothing to do with him trying to get a message to any fans.
Well, yeah, I can say is stay strong, because I've talked to a lot of kids that are just want to kill themselves, do all that stuff. It's just that things get better.
It feels good to know, like, somebody like John writing lyrics, and you listen to him, and you can actually relate and go, God, that happened to me, too. And it makes you feel good, you know? to know.
It gives music some meaning.
People come from rough backgrounds. It's not all Hanson and Spice Girls, you know. And he's just giving it from his heart, you know.
Jonathan writes about the real things out in life.
Yeah, everybody's hurt, and not many people can express it like he does. So.
People say they get their lives changed by what I write. That's the biggest reward in the world, and I don't have no problem with that. People are going to say that I've changed. If I actually change someone's life by just singing, I mean, that's the full reward. That's what you want to do in music. It's money or nothing like that. It's just what you feel in here. And I get that every day, so I'm the happiest person in the world right now.
What is it that is what you're presenting that people are really relating to? Is it that aggression? Is it
I think
that
it's aggression and the music. It just goes hand in hand. The music's the groove of it and the emotions I go through. I think that people can relate keen to either of those two things.
Once you have a kid, you totally go back and you understand why your parents did this and that, and it puts it in perspective.
Do you ever worry about repeating the same mistakes, and how are you going to avoid that?
There's no way around it. I mean, you can repeat. I can try, always try, but one of the things I was always mad at my dad about is because he was always gone on the road, and what am I doing right now? Mm. So there's things you can't help but do. So I guess I'll get through it. It'll be better for...
And complete vulnerability. On the next second, it's like... complete rage. Are those two sides of the same coin? Are those two, like, vulnerability and anger kind of tied close to you?
Yeah, it makes for good dynamics in a song. It's just easy. I mean, you do that to make dynamics in a song to make it go up and down. So I think they are hand in hand. They do it.
Are you, as a singer, are you going through those emotional shifts, like, as mercury, as quickly as it seems? Yeah.
Basically, yeah.
When writing lyrics, is it solely Jonathan's ideas that usually get put into the songs, or do you all put lyrics together?
No, it's all me.
Yeah.
I do all that.
Do you ever consult with the rest of your fans?
I just let them read this stuff. That's basically it. I couldn't be honestly sing somebody else's feelings. I just wouldn't be right doing that. So I usually take over those duties. That's what I do.
How do you get a groove? How do you achieve that chemistry that is Korn in the studio?
I guess it's always difficult writing songs. We just take our time and write and just experiment with different things and work things out until we're happy with it and it feels right.
I enjoy working with my band more than anyone.
So do I, because you know what? I feel there's a creative trust there. It's like when someone comes up with something, it's like, if it's not good, then it's you're let down easy by your friend. You know, it's not someone else going, that sucks. And you're like, damn, well, that's all like, I got, you know?
It's always every time, like, any of us make up something or write something, it's like, I can always be like, oh, I can put a bass line to what he just did, or like, we always can relate to like what we write.
When we write songs, we put nicknames on them until John writes the lyrics and comes up with a different name. So we nickname on them on bands.
You can't say can you play that one song?
So
we'll say like, can you play ZZ Top because it reminds us of that, or like
Steely Stones,
Halloween,
whatever. You got to name them because it's like, well, can you play song four? It's like too hard to remember. You know, like what was that one song you named? Was it John?
Was it called
Duran Duran?
Yeah, we heard Duran Duran.
He was playing them, and then I had a six string at home, and I joined the band, and I had to learn, and it took me like a month. I had to sit down and play because the neck's a lot wider. But you just got to get your hand used to it because it's thicker, you know. That's how we started. I mean, I started playing like this. So I had to reach my hand like that and reach the seventh string.
Yeah.
That's where that came from.
He doesn't want to play like that. He complains about his back hurting every night. Yeah. He just can't reach.
I got to reach the chord.
None of us be shit and start singing. That's it.
Tired, or do you feel energetic after you've performed?
Both. Tired and pumped up.
You come off stage pumped up, and you got your cool down period where you come off and then
there's some nights that you come off stage and fall over.
Yeah.
I mean, walk to the dressing room, I hit the ground, I'm just like,
tired.
It depends.
Some nights.
Depends on that night.
Right.
Some nights we'll walk in and just jumping around and drinking. I mean, I'm jumping around.
Who are you here to see?
Yeah, there you go.
Let's see the shoelaces. They're matching. Nice. Not bad. How are you feeling? You feeling good? I think I'm all right. You can't explain our live show. I mean, we don't know. We're on stage, but from what we hear from our fans, it's like, I guess, unreal, and like, they're blown away.
What's the best way to describe Korn, the Korn experience in 1999 right now? Is it seeing you guys on music videos, that listening to the CD, or is it seeing you live?
It's always, I think, about seeing us live. I don't know. What do you guys think?
I agree. I think the video just adds to it. It's all about the fun live show.
I wanted to wear something on stage that was like kind of trashy, dirty, you know? Because when I'm up there, I feel like that's who I am up there.
That's our hour a night to get all our aggressions out and everything we're pissed off about, we get out in that 1 hour period, and it leaves the rest of the time for us to have fun and get drunk.
I think we're powerful live because we feel the music and it's true, and we're not trying to portray anything that's, I don't know, prefabricated or trying to be something we're not. It's just raw emotion and heavy groove, and you can't deny any of that.
We love to play shows. We love to play in front of the crowd. We love to feel that adrenaline. We love to see them screaming out in the crowd for our music that we created.
This is one of the biggest, fattest production tours to ever hit in rock history.
Does it, like, is it sum up the true essence of what the Family Values Tour was? You got your CD, you got your video. Can you be there without being there?
I think you can relive it. It's pretty close, man.
Big rock tour, all about having fun, a bunch of bands being friends and having a good time on the road. It's cool. Good
it's
live
all there.
CD, live yeah. video.
All the bands yeah. sound good on it, actually.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
It's a good live CD that, I hate live CDs, and I would buy this one. It's good.
The video's cool, too. It's, you watch it and you have fun.
If parents and moms and dads start to like Korn, that's when we become not cool.
Did you guys retain any quality family values when you got off the road? I think it was right around Christmas time or so.
We always have good family values when it comes to our own families.
Yeah.
All of
but
us
as
do.
Far as the tour, everything we've ever done, it's just sarcasm. You know, because all these loud, rude bands on the tour. You know, Rammstein coming out, the fake little pecker. Can I say pecker? And, you know, I don't know.
The fire.
Has nothing to do with, like, our family values. When we go home, it's a whole, we leave our work at
Four magazine lately, but,
One other thing I gotta say before we get started. We're all from Los Angeles, California, and we live there, but for some reason, we sell more records in New York City.
I would say, we built our fan base up so big without the support of radio that there just came a time where they had to either start giving us some support or they would just be completely missing out because we're so big on the scene now.
Yeah.
It's kind of like they got to pick it up sometime or another.
Yeah.
They have no choice. We're starting to bust through. Heavy music is going to take over. So you can put away Third Eye Blind, all that crap they play.
Yeah.
People want real music.
The lead singer, he's got like the most awesome voice I've ever heard in my life.
You know, I don't think there's too many good bands anymore because everything is crap, man. But Korn, it's one of the few good bands left.
I crank up the lows and crank the highs. And I use a lot of the horns on the tent.
They're
play heavy without being stupid, not satanic.
They have the fattest guitar sounds. Everything's distorted. Their lyrics are great. Everything about them I like. First pulled up in the bus, the double-decker bus, and everyone's like, yeah! I was like, darn.
One, two, three.
Each band member, we all look like cartoon characters or something. Like you can, you know, most bands, you're like, what's the bass player's name? I don't know. Like, you know, bands today, and like we all like look like characters, so. We're like Motley Crue of the 90s.
Yeah, they can relate with each one of us. And yeah. That's it.
Everybody has their own, like, thing going. So.
There's a lot of other bands that are really big to the kids scene. Like they're on a different level than the kids, like they're older, more mature. Even though we are older than a lot of our fans, I think they feel like we're just kids just like they are, which we are pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Those kids are crazy, yo.
Okay, as you can see, it's still nuts, people chasing after the limo. Oh, look at this, check it out. Man, a handshake and a quick autograph and maybe some decapitation. That's one dedicated fan right there.
Give him cash, pay for his cab ride.
That's hilarious. Wow. Dedicated Korn fan number, what? 1,000,002?
Do you guys have any explanation why your fans are so dedicated to you?
It's more deep, intense music, and the kids get more involved into it and get more emotionally involved into the music rather than just like maybe a pop radio hit that doesn't really have much to it, just kind of a little catchy sing-along tune. I think it has a lot to do with it.
Okay, what is it about Korn that no other band has?
They're rad wicked! They're cool! They're actually cool!
Toronto's number one.
Yeah, right. Toronto.
So even beats New York?
Man, that was crazier in New York. I don't understand that crap. Okay. That was fresh. That was so fresh. I'm going to move here.
Okay. That was, you know what?
It's a dream come true. And it's all because of the fans. You know what I mean? And all those people, all those fans, we thank them so much.
Our fans is because we let our fans in our personal life. I mean, we put out like videos about personal things about us and things that like that if I was a fan like that, I would like to see
what's Fielding eat for breakfast, and you know,
that's interesting.
Does he use a Mickey Mouse spoon or a regular spoon?
Okay, we're gonna go with some diarrhea wrapped up in a tortilla.
Number seven right there with no sour cream.
Number seven.
I think I'm gonna go with the original taco. Yeah. And probably a chili cheese burrito, because that makes my stomach feel real good.
That chili does it right, you know? I think I'm going to go for extra large Pepsi, extra large Pepsi, extra large Pepsi, and a Maxi Melt.
If I was a fan and a kid, I would love to see this right now.
You find there's a fine line, though, between what's personal and what's private? Because there has to be a line somewhere.
Yeah, me laying in bed naked's private. Me not laying in bed, walking around the bed with clothes on is okay. Yeah, there is a fine line, yeah.
I drew my fine line. I don't think I would do much more personal stuff because...
You got people coming to your house knocking on your door now? Fieldy there? I know he lives there.
I moved.
I just saw your house on TV.
Yep, and I moved.
Did you get it?
Yeah.
I never know those cameras.
I just saw it like a half an hour ago.
Oh, really?
Are you comfortable maybe with the fact that now you're all role models for people out there?
I don't think we're quite...
I gotta quit
people
drinking.
That kids need to have as role models.
But I don't think any of us are role models, but I think kids look up to us, so like maybe the way we dress, and they want to like be like us and look like us. You always see the head hairdo everywhere, and you know, just, but I don't think it's a role model like, oh, I want to copy them and do this or that. I think it's gonna think there's maybe more want to dress like us and look like us. I don't know if that's a role model.
You busted out the hairstyles. I see like a lot of people here.
It's called the head dude.
The head dude.
They look better than mine. Next record, we're gonna find some whack ass clothes and dress all stupid and see if people copy us.
We become businessmen now. Definitely. I mean, we have our own record label.
How involved are you in the day-to-day of Elementary Records?
Creative side.
Basically, we're the
A&R.
The A&R promotion department.
That's it.
You're looking at them.
We've got so much people in the hip-hop world coming to us that you just got to draw the line sometimes.
Just put a big family.
Well, if we wanted to, we could be on every hip-hop record in the country. That sounds like kind of a little cocky, but we get a lot of phone calls, man, for people asking us to do this or that. And it's like, you can't sell yourself out to be a whore. You got to like eventually be like, hey, man, enough's enough.
Are you at your best right now?
Yeah.
We're at our prime right now.
Really?
Yeah. We're feeling good. We're rocking it.
We're better now than we were on Family Values. Mm. We're at our prime.
We're all like less stressed out than we've ever been as a band. It's back to like almost when we were first starting out. We were starving and like we wanted to play those live shows and give the best that we could give. We're back to that again. I don't know why, but
history repeats itself.
I guess so.
I think it's the adrenaline that everyone's feeling. Just seeing the changing in our crowds, how everything's just getting bigger and crazier, and everyone's starting to recognize us, and it's really just pumping our adrenaline up, and we're just excited all the time.
Yeah,
it's feeling good. Leading a new generation of kids like his art does and his comics. He wanted to. What we were told is Todd said that he kind of considered us the Doors of the 90s.
That's pretty cool. Powerful statement.
That's pretty nice of him to say that, huh?
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
Who's the Doors?
Nominations, how do you feel about that?
We feel really, really overwhelmed. It's been a long time. We worked a long time to get where we're at. And feel like tonight we're kind of getting honored for it. So, I mean, it's a good feeling. So, and we're keeping our fingers crossed.
Look what we're eating. The same, glamorous. We pull over in our limo to Taco Bell. We're not going to change if we sell a little bit more records, you know? It's the same. We're just getting a limo.
Yeah.
We'll mess it up.
We don't want the kids to think like things are changing for us, you know, because we're getting bigger. I mean, we go on stage every night, and John thanks the whole crowd every night for being there for us and making everything happen this way. And we just don't want kids to think that because our fan base is getting even bigger now that we're not Korn, we're not still their band, because we're still a kids' band. Uh-huh. And we've never been about the media. It's always been about playing music and fans.
It's hard now because there's so many fans now. It's not like the old days when we had like 200 kids, you know, coming to our little club and we could go out there and hang out with them and talk to them. It's just on a bigger, way bigger scale now. So the little things, anything we can do just to let them know, hey, we still care about them, and we're not stuck up and full of ourselves.
To see 350,000 heads, like, what does that do to you?
Adrenaline rush.
We're gonna have to see, because we've never seen that before.
I don't know, we haven't played yet, so this is the biggest thing we've ever done in our career, so
it's gonna be pretty crazy though.
I'm sorry,
I might poo-poo.
Come on, what's
the
94 Woodstock was kind of criticized because they thought that they shouldn't have a peace and angle or peace and love angle to it, that it wasn't about that in 94. This one's being criticized for the same reason. Does it matter to you? Do you sense a bit of harmony around something like this?
That was all the way back in 69 when that peace and love crap was going on. It ain't going on
now. I was barely coming out of the nut sack. I was born in 69.
I was not even born yet, so I don't really give a flying, you know what.
We're into peace and love.
It's an awesome festival.
Dude.
But the hippies are dead now.
I'm not into that hippie crap. We ain't hippies here.
I like to take care of myself.
Well, maybe Korn sort of has their own way of talking about peace and love. Do you want to elaborate, or maybe you don't?
Yeah, scream your head off, and you'll feel better. Now, so why let's.
The fact that you're maybe playing to someone else's audience, maybe a goal of doing some.
We ain't playing to nobody else's audience. It's all us.
It's all ours.
There are some Korn shirts out there, we're not even sweating that. You might be nervous if you're one of these other bands, but you know we got a lot of love out there.
Conceptual in the fact that it's just the story of what I went through when once Follow the Leader came out, and my problems, my battling, my anxiety, and the problems I had in my head, and going through family values, and all of a sudden attention brought towards our band and fame. So I mean, it tells the whole story of all the thoughts and things that went through my head during that period of time. So all the songs relate to the same thing. It's all just one running theme.
Who had the idea to solicit album art from your fans?
Actually, our manager, Jeff Blundetz, who we kind of consider a sixth member of the band. We were just talking about doing more than one cover. And then he called us one day up all excited, like a little kid, like he gets, because he gets so excited about things. And he said, like, let's do a contest and let our fans pick the cover art. And everyone was just like, wow, that is just an amazing idea.
Okay, so who picked it? Did your fans pick the cover art?
No, we picked the cover.
Why did you pick this one?
We all liked it. There's others that a couple of us loved. But, like, someone else wouldn't like us.
If you could give anybody advice that's in kind of a crazy situation, what would you suggest to them?
If you can go get help, there's all kinds of things they can do. Just don't stick around and stay in it. And it always gets better, and don't give up.
Right.
Like taking your life and stuff like that's just not the answer. But I mean, there's so many different things you can do.
We had a stack of treatments from different people that wanted to direct the video, and his just happened to be the best one. So that's why
it'd be a really good thing. It was nice working with another musician because he understands what it's like shooting a video as a musician. So as a director, he shoots it the way he would want it shot as a musician. So it was good.
It was all fun. Probably the most laid-back video we've done. Still going through tests, all kinds of stuff on his arm.
So his wrist just stopped working.
Yeah, no pain. It just it just went like this.
Wow.
And he couldn't feel the pain or nothing. He just.
David's like, I think the perfect guy would be is Mike Gordon. And we're man. You know, David's a man. He's a drummer. He knows.
Call him up.
Who would be the best man to do it?
He got on the phone that night.
Yeah, right there at midnight. And Mike Morton said he went out
Fargo,
that night.
Yep.
Went to the music store that night at midnight, all night, listened to all the songs for like 2 days, just straight over and over and over, and then came in and we played a show 2 days later.
Dark and depressing in a lot of places here.
Really?
Yeah, like France. And does France see this?
It don't matter.
It doesn't matter. He's never coming back.
Yeah, I'm never coming back.
It's like a heavier feel. Like people are.
The only thing good about touring here is the hour and a half or whatever on stage.
Yeah.
It's the only thing we love.
You're getting a shitty interview off us because we're depressed and miserable.
Why are you so depressed, man?
We don't have Taco Bell here.
The most gratifying part of all that's going on is just being able to wake up in the morning and not go to a 9-to-5 job and do something that I actually love and really, really, really respect doing. I mean, it's my life. It's what I love to do is play music. And I just thank God every day when I wake up that I can be, that I can do this. I don't have to go to a job. And my job is something I love. And that's all. I don't care where it takes us, the fame, you know, can go away just as long as I can make music, I'm happy.